Tulsa to see my precious Joy graduate from Oral Roberts University. It's a dream of hers. So today is, it just feels like, I hope I don't cry my whole face off, right? About 30 minutes ago, but I'm on the road now. Yes. It's not till 1. It only takes me 2 hours to get there, so I'll get there a little after 12. So when you watch someone, it's just this blessing, right? To watch someone grow and accomplish and fail forward. And she's graduating with high honors, and I think she may be a speaker. I know there were 5 chosen to submit, and she submitted, but there were only 3 that were going to get to speak. So she didn't tell me either way, so I don't know if she just forgot to tell me or she didn't. She wasn't one of them chosen. But in her story, I think she was, I don't know, she, because she was so bilingual, she thought in Spanish and spoke in English, that she struggled with her studies in early grade school. She was kind of behind the rest of the kids, and so she worked very hard to catch up. And I know when she started working for me at 17, she's 22 now, I could tell she thought in Spanish and she spoke in English, but she doesn't do that anymore. She thinks in English, and she's obviously very fluent in Spanish, but I just adore her, and I'm so a little emotional about getting to go over and watch her. I keep saying I'm not going to cry. My nose is running. I remember at Rachel's graduation, my oldest, the whole room right before they got up, started walking up there. The whole room was, well, they asked us, many families, this is the first person in your family. I mean, you're now, my older sister did graduate from college, and my little sister graduated with a degree in education. My older sister's an electrical engineer. But they said, how many is this the first? And my husband's family, this is the first person that's ever graduated from college. Our both of our daughters did. And it was just emotional, you know, it was gratitude to God. It was, I think, appreciating and valuing all the work that these kids did. They're not kids anymore, right? Just the work. And Rachel worked a full-time job. Just the work that they did. And, you know, Joy is in full-time ministry. She was a chaplain for her floor, and she also came over every weekend from Tulsa back to Fayetteville to minister at her church, because she is a music minister in praise and worship, and she helps with the children. And since this is not like she was dating or playing any of that. That's not what was happening. She has worked so hard. was great exercise, and I was one of these that had to work extra hard to learn the routines, because I don't know if someone, if it just wasn't my gift, or someone had told me that I couldn't dance when I was young, or that I was not graceful or whatever, but that definitely carried over into my adult life, and so I was manifesting what others had told me, and but I did, I could do the funky chicken. Enough to teach these little kids the correct routine, and at the end of every quarter we get up and do a performance and it be in costumes, and it was adorable. Oh my goodness, I adored them. One really hard thing happened. I don't know why I'm being random. I danced in this church preschool, which was a wonderful preschool. All things considered, no child wants to go to preschool. If they have a good home life, they would rather be home. I saw children that were not happy about being dropped off, were very happy to be picked up, and just did not feel loved while they were there at some of the preschools, right? So, and I got offered jobs from several of them. Please come on staff. I'm like, oh, it's okay. coming into the church, visiting, and he was praying. You know, and so just talking to God about this, saying, well, in my life, not necessarily in this life, but in my life, what even little things, right? Little things that we refuse to give up, little habits, when God can be very tolerant of these things until he asks you to give them up. And when you say no, you're in disobedience, and disobedience is sin. So that was just kind of my thought today about where am I missing it? So today, the other day, and this year, my word is honor. God gave me my word for the year, and it's honor. And so I was mad at a dog, and I was calling it a dumb dog, dumb something dog, and God said, that's not honor. You're missing it. So how many times in life, in our everyday life, does something come up and we want to complain, or we want to, in actuality, I was cursing the dog when I was calling it dumb. Said, you need to live with honor. And even though this dog's aggravated you, we're not going to call him dumb, okay? And so I run this filter, right? Would Jesus have said that? No, I don't think so. So, would Jesus have thought that? No, I don't think so. So I'm not going to think it either. So think that, take that as, we took a measuring tape and we measured Max yesterday, and God says in the Old Testament, there's a plumb line, and what he meant by that is, my husband's hanging sheetrock today, that's why he's not able to go to this function he wanted to go to, because his helper was only available today to go help him, so, a plumb line, let's talk about what a plumb line is. If you hang a string weight on the end of it, it's going to hang perfectly horizontal to the floor, right? And create a 90 degree angle. That's how you get your house straight. It's the crooked one. And our builder is amazing. And so it is, everything is very straight. So it's not going to be difficult to, we're not going to have to be doing this with the sheetrock to get it to seam and meet it. Although, I mean, technically, I mean, even all the sheets may not be exactly perfectly like they should be, right and straight. But the plumb line, let's drop the plumb line of the Word of God into our life and see where we're missing it. Because if our purpose is to bring God glory, we don't want, sin separates us from God. We don't want to miss the mark. We don't want to miss the mark. Whatever it is that he's called us to do, to speak to this person, to bless that person, to invest here, to not to invest there, right? We don't want to miss God, even in the small things. So that was what I want to talk about today. Just encourage you to ask the Holy Spirit, where am I sinning? Even in little things, because sin separates me from God. And if Jesus, and he is here, but if you could see him with your physical eyes, right? And he's beckoning us to come to him. Come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That's what he said. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. If you are burdened today, you just need Jesus. He's all we need. And how do we get more of Jesus? Get in the Word of God. Jesus is the Word of God. John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus is the Word of God. Get in your Bible and in the Word of God. If you can't understand the King James, go get you a Passion Translation. Amplified Bible. Mama Joyce uses it sometimes. It's no excuse. If you're not understanding the Word of God, then definitely just ask the Holy Spirit to open the Word to you, and He will. It's His love letter to us. He wants us to know what the Word says, and you know what is speaking into our life. I promise you, if you open the Word of God and read until there's a scripture that jumps out to you and the Holy Spirit quickens it to your spirit, and you say, oh, you know that OIC factor, that's for me, you know. And that was the first verse that I learned out of the Message Bible. And this is interesting, most scripture that I learned was out of the King James or the NIV before 1984. So I was actually trying to quote Psalms 1 out of the NIV and did not read the same as I had learned it. And I thought, this is not right. Something's wrong, because I know I had learned this. And so then I got to looking up on the internet, and it said that was before 1984. Now there's a different NIV, and it does read a little different in Psalms 1:1. It does read a little different. So I haven't decided if I'm going to learn it a little different or what. I should, because the truth is, don't say I can't learn scripture. You can. If you know your phone number, you can learn scripture. It's just a matter of repetition. So there's three rules to memorizing scripture: review, review, review. You got it. So, and if you review it while you're singing it, or you are playing, I read this the other day, it said, if you learn something while you're playing, like a child learning something, it can be done less than 40 times. If you're just insisting that you memorize something, just cold memorization, you have to do it almost 400 times. So I thought that was interesting. So when you're memorizing scripture, learning scripture, just ask the Holy Spirit to help you. And I would say this. It's kind of like with dog training. You see someone with a well-trained dog, and people think, oh, well, it's just the dog. No, it's not. It's the training. It's the training. It's the practice. It's the, you know, and so it's the same way with the Word of God. It's the review. So, in the Passion Translation in Romans 15:1, it says, those who are mature in Christ can easily be recognized, for they do not live to please themselves, but patiently embrace others in their immaturity. And that just spoke to me more than, you can look it up, Romans 15:1 in the NIV. It doesn't read like that at all. And so that just really spoke to me, because if you think you're mature, and yet you're unwilling to be patient with those that are immature, you're not mature. And let me see if I can get this one, because I have practiced this. The next one is, for our, verse 2, our goal must be to empower others to choose what is right and good, to bring them into spiritual maturity. And then it goes on down in verse 4, and I mean 3 and 4, and it talks about Jesus did not live to please himself, but he crawled upon that cross and he died for us. And so, and may we arm ourselves, I think this is in Philippians 2, may we arm ourselves with that like-mindedness, that we would be willing to lay our life down for others, right? Anyway, the Bible, oh people, read it. It's life-changing. It's amazing. It's alive. It's powerful. It's Jesus. So let me pray for you today. Father, as we put our armor on, our helmet of salvation and our breastplate of righteousness, may we gird our loins about with truth. Show us anywhere we're believing a lie. We shed our feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Sorry, that's kind of a hard place to get out. We take our sword of the Spirit and our shield of faith, wherewith we'll quench all the fiery darts of the enemy. We put our armor on today, Ephesians 6, so that we'll be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. in that verse and praying in the Holy Spirit. So we take our sword of the Spirit, our shield of faith, and praying in the Holy Spirit on all occasions. May we stand against the enemy. Thank you, Lord. And pray for my friends watching here 24 minutes in, that we be careful, even those little sins, white lies, exaggerating, such things, white lie, even little things, Lord, may we bring you honor. May we choose your way instead of our own way. In the name of Jesus.